Welcome to a special edition of the B3 GamingCast. This is Janzer, your host, as usual. In this episode, CountShockula and myself talk with Ship of Heroes founder Casey McGeever, CEO of Heroics Inc., and Matthew Wilson, lead developer of Heroics Inc. We get information about the environment of Ship of Heroes, the function of the ship itself, the engine, the gaming engine it's created on, level caps for characters when the game first comes out, a bit of insight on the business model, how are they going to stay, you know, functioning, how the gameplay is going to work, info on powers available, a walkthrough of the character creator, and really just quite a lot more. I'd like to say we were very excited about having the opportunity to talk with Heroics, and really do appreciate those guys giving us an opportunity for that. I just said opportunity twice. Hopefully you all enjoy this conversation led by Count. Count Chocula really put this all together, and my thanks goes out to him, of course. We're jumping right in with Casey McGeever leading us through what we're seeing on the Skype call. Hope you all enjoy.
We're probably standing pretty much in front of the City Hall, and we're looking at a couple of giant statues. We're looking at Heroic Plaza, and in the distance you can see the Arch. You can see most of the downtown of the city. So the city is placed inside a giant spaceship. The ship has 20 habitable levels, and each level can have a city in it. Our aspiration is to have an above ground and a below ground part of each level. In addition to that, the ship is obviously a spaceship. It docks at planets. It visits space stations, and it can contact and interact with other spaceships in the long vision of the game development, right? So what we have here is this is the first persistent level. You can see some robots walking around. This is about 1.25 square miles of territory. Gentlemen, I can talk all day about this game. I'm very excited about it. So if you want to squeeze some questions in, do feel free.
Now, what engine was City of Heroes built with? Do you know?
That is a good question. I don't know, actually, because it was... Okay. I think originally coded back in 2002 and released in 2004.
Right. I knew it was like outdated. I knew the kind of like Champions Online. It seems like that is, they have some camera issues and whatnot. So I wasn't sure what engine they were built with. Correct. I knew you guys were using Unreal Engine 4, but.
Just over a year ago, we did a lot of investigation of different engines. I actually spoke to senior technical and business leaders from five different engine companies. And we pretty quickly zeroed in on Epic's Unreal Engine 4 as the tool for us. Because we want to make an MMO, because of its graphical power, because Epic's doing a fabulous job updating it and adding new features constantly, it's a really powerful platform for us.
And it's didn't they make it free?
They did make it free, like, although you pay 5% of gross revenue after the game goes live. So it's not completely free.
Yeah, there's always a catch. I mean,
yes. So we got a very happy robot right there walking across the screen. That is because we have actually coded mood and interactions into the NPC civilians in the game. So they go and talk to each other. And as a result of the conversations, their mood can change. They can be mad. They can be happy. They can be indifferent. They can be determined. And it shows up in the animations of their motion after that. Also, Matt was just showing... Sorry, Matt, turn us around just for... Well, yeah, those two guys are talking.
Yeah, what are we looking at there? Yeah.
That is an early concept rendering of the ship itself.
Yeah.
And what you can see, we actually have a video on this, how the ship's laid out.
I did see that, yeah.
You can see that the front part is shaped for ramming. And we are thinking we're going to have some interesting space-related activities later in the game. But first, quite honestly, we're building the hero portion in the ship, in the cities of the ship, and then we will probably move to introduce some planets because, you know, we think that'll give the best player experience. But there are definitely going to be space elements in this game as well.
Cool.
Now, you talked about 20, you had like 20 levels within the ship.
Correct.
Are those going to be like, is there going to be like a port? Like a portal you go to get to the other level, or is it like a queued instance, or?
You'll probably jump into the elevators and move up, the transporters.
Okay. So there'll be like a physical
level to level. if you've, you know, lots of games that are, lots of MMOs that are theme park style, you know, the first level, like what we're seeing here with Apotheosis City, might be levels 1 through 6 or 1 through 10. When you're a level 50 character, we still plan to have content for you to come back to Apotheosis City for, but you'd be fighting and leveling and having adventures on higher levels of the ship with greater challenge.
I see. So that's going to be your level cap to start, level 50?
When we launch, I don't know if we'll be at 50. We may be at 30, right?
Oh, okay. Because I see.
Undoubtedly, we're going to launch a game and then expand it. Our commercial plan is actually just recycle all the revenues back into building the game. We think that's what provides the best long-term player experience. And also, we think that the community that's interested in this game, because it is an MMO, they don't want to play it, you know, one and done. It's not a three-month effort where you shoot through, see the content, and move on.
Right.
It's a social experience where you meet your friends, you do stuff with them, you form guilds, you repeat the content because it's going to be immersive and fun. And in that environment, we need to be constantly expanding the amount of content. But we also think that when we're doing that, players will stay for years, hopefully for decades.
Right. Well, that's always kind of the issue with MMOs, players burning through content, you know, too quickly, and then they complain they have nothing to do for the next whatever, you know, for like the big title MMOs like Destiny and stuff like that, you know. So
correct.
Yeah, that's kind of the challenge, is to keep players like coming back, you know.
That's right.
Yeah, given that,
of course you have to have immersive, fascinating content.
Right.
If either of you had played City of Heroes, I don't think maybe you did, but if you had, you would have seen that a lot of the content, people would repeat it. I myself, when I played City of Heroes, I ended up with 60 characters who were all level capped as incarnates. And that's because I did the content again and again and again with different characters who had wildly different powers.
Right.
Yeah. And that is a feature of this game. It is one thing to run through the content as a tank. It's another thing to run through it as a devastator. It's completely different to run through it as a support player. And there are multiple kinds of support players. And in that list, I didn't even cover if you were a melee damage or if you were a hybrid character with your powers. Because there will be probably on the order of 500 powers to choose from, and you're going to end up with something like 15 of them, the power combinations are going to matter a lot. Oh, by the way, that shot right there, that shows something interesting about the game and how we developed the first persistent level, Apotheosis City. What you can see is that building has some platforms sticking out of it. Mm-hmm. Lots of the buildings do, because first we laid out the city using urban design principles. In other words, the way an architect or an architectural studio would actually lay out a city. And second off, we planned for it to be in the 25th century, so buildings would obviously have places for flying heroes to land.
Right.
You don't just enter the building at the ground floor. You enter in lots of places.
Cool.
I'm sorry. I told you guys you were in danger. I can talk for hours about this. But
No, that's fine.
I should let you ask questions and not monologue you.
Yeah, I want to ask real quick about the repeated quest. Is there going to be anything in there RNG quest related, kind of like mixing up the content so you're not playing exactly the same missions or quests?
Yes.
Okay.
So maps can change. New content will come out. Also, you'll be able to individually set the difficulty level of the mission. So let's say you've got three of your buddies and maybe you're playing and there's a football game on that you already know how it's going to come out, but you're kind of keeping an eye on it and you're playing distracted. Maybe you want to play at normal difficulty. Maybe you've got three of your buddies and you're all ace players. You want to dial the difficulty up where there are no minions. All the minions are replaced with lieutenants, all the lieutenants with captains. All the captains have been replaced with bosses, and the boss that was in that mission is now a super boss, right? Maybe there are five times as many enemies. You'll be able to do that kind of stuff, dial it up and down. That was a feature in City of Heroes that was actually really effective for enabling new players to come in and enabling skilled players to find an appropriate level of challenge.
Yeah, that's great. Yep, that's always a really nice feature in games.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So it'd be like a tier system or like a difficulty slider
correct.
Type thing. Okay, I got you.
Correct. Another element is we want to bring back a feature that we really like, which is we want to enable players to design their own missions and then offer them up to the player base. So that was a feature in City of Heroes. It's a feature in some other games. We want to create that too, because we don't think we've got a some sort of monopoly on creativity.
Right.
So we think as well, a lot of these things make the game stickier, more immersive. The players know what they want to do. They really have good ideas, and we trust our players to deliver good stuff.
Go ahead, Janzer.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So given, I know one of the things that draws me to games and keeps me there too is, and I know it seems silly, but it's the design of your character. So you have the character creator, and I know you said that in the long run, you're looking to launch the game and then have revenue kind of refund or fund the forward progress of anything else that comes along. So cosmetics.
Yes.
Yeah. That's what I'm looking for as well. You know, purchasable cosmetics, I'm assuming, would be part of the thing that you could put for revenue, I'm guessing.
Probably yes. But actually, before you get to purchasable cosmetics, mm-hmm. as you put it, we already have a character creator built into this mm-hmm. game that we think is really advanced. And you can see the giant statue theme here. We like that.
Yeah.
So these statues are a pair, and they actually in-game have a name called the Hill of the Beginning. And that refers to the fact that in our game, heroes don't have secret identities. Mm-hmm. Part of what we're saying about the future here is that this ship is in space, it's under attack, but it's also doing good work. You know, it's protecting humanity, it's doing a lot of good stuff. Heroes provide that little extra oomph that keeps the ship successful and alive, that helps the human species expand. And because of that, the human culture aboard the ship is largely united. People admire their heroes. If you think about Batman and Superman, you know, they had their characters, Bruce Wayne and Clark Kent, who were secret identities, mm-hmm. because basically Batman and Superman are acting outside of the legal system in which they're supporting. They're illegal characters, in a sense, if you talk to the Attorney General of those universes.
Right, right.
That is not true here. Yeah. Our characters, our heroes anyway, are part of the ship. They're supporting it, and the society is supportive of them. This statue in the backstory shows the last fight between heroes who had secret identity. So it's a long time in the past.
That was
a big backstory bit.
Well, no, that's fine. It's kind of like Legion of Superheroes if you're going to do like DC. You know, I don't know if you're familiar with them. You know, it's like it's just like a huge clan of heroes that inhabit the future. And none of them have secret identities. They're just a giant legion of heroes, just like the title says. But I kind of had a question. Are you going to have villains? I mean, are you going to have the villain option, or is this just playing heroes, the hero side?
Right now, we're going to open with heroes.
Okay. Because I know City of Heroes, didn't they have later on they had City of Villains or City of...
Yes, they did.
They had like an expansion.
And later on, they merged them together
into
a combined game, which, by the way, had an interesting effect, which was people would make villains... And then in that game, they would transform them over to heroes because the archetypes and the powers available on the villain side were, to some players, more interesting than the ones available on the hero side. So they
had different power sets. I didn't know that. See, like in DC Universe, you just pick, do you want hero or villain? And everyone shares the same power set.
So it's an interesting lesson learned in right. that. We would now say we would we would do the same thing DC Universe is doing, where we would say, well, the powers should be available for everyone. There will, however, be super-powered villains in the game that you fight against.
Right.
In terms
like
of
an open world boss type.
Yeah, this is, as you can probably tell, because you're inside the ship, we do not have the open world, although we have a large world here. When we get to planets, we probably will be doing more of an open world approach. And at some point, I think players will probably get the ability to play as bad guys. But one of the keys about making an MMO, it's a big task.
It's huge. Yeah.
In our design philosophy, we want to control the scope of the job so we actually launch a game.
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, if you look at this, we've made a pretty large map here. We've shown the ships.
Oh, yeah.
See more maps coming. You know, we've got the powers. We've got the backstory. You can kind of tell we could launch what we have right here as a game, although we want to launch actually both the underground sections and at least one more level at launch, right?
Right.
And
right.
then pretty rapidly go to a first planet, because that would be a very interesting setup. You could do a lot just with that territory. But, of course, the city here that we're showing you is largely empty, but it won't be when the game is played.
So you'll have like quest giver NPCs all around, or
absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
We have introduced our first two signature heroes, who are named Sword Blossom and Ambassador. I think possibly later today we're going to actually put out the costume for the next signature hero as well, because we'd like to give people a chance to look at the costume pieces. How you're dressed in a superhero game matters a lot.
Yeah.
And you asked us a little bit ago about the character creator. You know, maybe we should flip to that, Matt, and just jump into it. You guys have probably seen the video, so you've seen something about the city here, Apotheosis City, but you notice, just putting it bluntly, it's beautiful. It is not post-apocalyptic and grimy.
Right.
There will be playing maps where you see that stuff, but the city itself is actually a future city. This is our vision of a future for humanity.
So what building would have, I'm sure you'll have like a social hub.
Correct.
Kind of where you...
We're going to put something in here that is a social hub, like a nightclub. What we've noticed, though, is in other games, players often choose their own place to hang out.
Right.
So, you know, just again, referring to City of Heroes as an example, you find out that people like to hang out under the giant statues. And if you looked at Star Wars, a lot of people hang out in the space stations.
Right.
Right. There are social hubs. But some people actually hang out on particular worlds in Star Wars because, you know, they're more interested in that location. Right. So people find spots they want to hang. We're not going to try to, like, compel the players to hang out in a particular place, but we're going to give them options.
But what I meant was, like, you're going to have, like, a kind of like a Hall of Justice type building, right? Where, or absolutely. Something like, I mean, I'm not trying to have you speculate or anything, but I meant, what building, did you already have that in mind? What building that would be here on your map, or?
We do not.
Do not. Okay. All right.
There are a couple of cool options, and honestly, the dev team's not united on that decision yet, so.
Oh, okay. All right. I don't want to pry.
Internal discussion.
Yeah, let me know if, I mean, there's, you know, any question I ask that you don't want to release that info yet or something like that, you know, just say, hey, you know.
We're pretty open. We try to be right. Transparent. It's a goal for the enterprise.
Okay. All right.
Matt, do you want to flip us over to the character creator?
Yep, sure thing.
Yeah, the city looks impressive. No, there's no doubt.
Of course, everyone who makes a game is proud of their game, so you can probably guess.
Oh, that. Yeah.
We're proud of this
hell
course.
Yeah.
Are there going to be any community, other than the, like, quest creating, which I don't think I've seen in a game for a while in any of the games that I've played. I know I've heard some games say, we're looking to do this, you know, player-driven quest system, but it never came to fruition. Outside of that, are there going to be any player modding type of things? Like, I'm playing with modding the user interface for 7 Days to Die right now, and it's something that really ties me to the game. Like, I think I have, like, an extra 60 hours in that game just because I'm working on modding the UI. So, because that's something I can mess with. I've done web development for like 8 years already. So I'm like, oh, this is really interesting. I can actually play with this. And it kind of ties me to the game even more.
Yeah, we want to offer our players a chance to customize the game. Customization is a big part of any MMO. You can customize your powers. You can customize your character's appearance. We've actually had a very interesting forum thread going on where people were asking for the ability to customize the UI. So the health and energy bars, you know, where does stuff go? Right now, our UI, you can move everything around. It's all movable. There's only one item that we had to limit. It can go in two spots at the current moment, but everything else can go anywhere on the screen.
Nice.
Cool.
Nice.
Also, we've got some other specific ideas for changing the UI and making it really cool. We think there are a lot of UIs that we think are kind of dull now. Of course, that's an aesthetic decision, right? But we like to go back and forth with our community and show stuff on our forums and say, what do you guys think of this? Because we believe we should, and we do, take direction from the player base. So yeah. Go ahead, Matt. So we're going to show you character creator as it is right now. So looks like we're going to create a new character. And you can see you can choose archetypes here.
Okay. So, tank, melee, range, support. Okay.
Yes. Well, now we're actually going to put in some names. For example, our ranged is going to be Devastator. We may stay with tank because it's such a generic term, but people understand what that is.
Yeah, I think City of Heroes used tanker. I think tanker was the, yeah.
And then their range was really blaster.
Blaster, so right.
We're going with Devastator, and our Devastator is not the same as the City of Heroes blaster. A City of Heroes blaster had primary and secondary power sets that were both damaged. So they were, in the words of that game, a glass cannon.
Right. Right?
All damage. Couldn't take two hits, though, which made them tricky to play.
Yeah.
We're actually going for a little different. We're going for damage and buff. So
okay. Okay.
So that would mean that a tank would be able to do a lot of range damage. I'm sorry, a tank. I meant a Devastator would be able to do a lot of range damage. But they'd also be able to buff themselves up for peak combat. You know, if you're in a big boss fight and you need to be really tough for 20 more seconds, a Devastator would have that ability. Not all the time, but you could really get the peak combat capability up.
Also, now, you're going to have a crowd control? Any powers that lean toward like a crowd control type option?
Absolutely. We want to do that. We're not going to, well, I shouldn't say that. Right now, we have not promised to have that at launch.
Okay. But
I played crowd control characters, and I run this company, so I like crowd control. But at the same time, you know, that requires some extra coding that we have not completed yet. So we're not at a point. We think it'd be terrible if we promised something and didn't deliver it. So we're pretty careful about what we promise. We know we can do all of these.
Yeah.
And support is heals, obviously.
It can be it can also be buff.
And buff. Okay.
Right.
I got you.
We like a game where certain things are true. So we'd like a game where basically you could set the difficulty up high and any team of eight could succeed, right? But we also like a lot of team combat. We like a lot of team content. That could be PvE and also team PvP. Now, yeah. I'm saying that with the full knowledge that the first 4 or 5 months that I played City of Heroes, I don't think I was on a team. I soloed the whole thing up, right? Because it was the first MMO I really got into. It was very exciting. It was early days in MMOs, right? And I was nervous about not being good enough to be on a team.
Right.
Later on, I think, you know, once you have 60 incarnate level players, you become good, right? But I think people should be able to solo, but we do want to make it fun. It's a social game as well as a just get in and kill stuff game, right? So teaming should be fun, and we want to have the archetypes work together so the team is stronger than eight individuals.
I see. Were you planning on putting in content that was less than eight people in a group? Like,
sure.
I know you're talking about solo, but maybe like duo or like four, like a four man
absolutely.
Or what? Okay.
What we like, there will almost certainly be content where you can lots of content where you can choose the number of players you want to go in. And then there will be, so you could do two, you could do one, you could do two, you could do eight. And the difficulty of the content will scale up based on how many players you have.
Okay.
There will be some content where you need four players or you need two players, you know, because it's the lowest level of difficulty is still so high that it would be very difficult to solo it. Now, I know from experience that once we say, hey, this requires four players, there will be some guy saying, I've designed the perfect character. I can solo that mission. You know,
yeah, always.
You can always get three friends who drop and go do it, you know. But I guess we would say we warned you.
Yeah. Now does your, are you going to have stat banding where your stats, you're never going to be so overpowered to do like, or you know what I mean? Like level scaling is what I guess I should be saying. Say you're a level 50 character and you go into a level 20 mission, or I'm just using an example. Will your stats band back to like level 20?
Yes.
Type or, yes. Or will you? Okay.
Yes, they will. So okay. It will definitely level scale you, and that'll be up and down.
Oh, okay. So I got
up
you.
Is a little trickier, right?
Because trickier. Yeah.
If you're actually like a level 6 or 8 player and somebody adds you to a team that has level 30 content, mm-hmm. you may not have enough powers to be really a killer on that. But we want you to be able to, you know, take a crack at it and not drag the team down, not embarrass yourself. But, you know.
Yeah. That's something
that's a balancing issue. But yeah, we would like for a level 6 to be able to join a level 20 or level 30 team and contribute significantly.
I see.
That's something that Elder Scrolls Online got, you know, they did that really well, which allowed a lot of us that joined at different times in that game's cycle to actually play together, which was amazing. Because that's one of those issues where, oh, I'm level 4, you're level 36. Sorry, we can't play together, even though we're friends. We're, you know. But that's going to be amazing. That's good.
That kind of stinks. So we're deliberately, again, we emphasize a lot of the design elements around community. You should be able to play with your buddies. If your buddies are level 40 and they convince you to join the game and make a new level 1 or level, you know, you should be able to do something with them pretty quick.
Instead of leaving them alone for we're going to leave you alone for a week. You go ahead and level up and then call us when you're ready or something like that. Yeah. They're going to be able to actually,
exactly. Now, if they're actually level 40 and you're level 1, they better be your friends because they might be carrying you a little bit. But
Well, that's always an issue. Yeah.
Right.
Hey, I had a question. Are you going to have some sort of, I'm not sure how City of Heroes did it. I know how DC Universe does it, and it's one of the, well, I better withhold what I'm saying until I get your answer, but are you going to have like a scorecard like that, like the end of a mission where you show, well, everyone shows the damage, you're going to have some sort of scorecard.
Yeah, Warframe does that too, yeah.
I don't like the scorecards in MMOs. I really don't. I think it adds to the toxicity of the game.
We were not thinking about the scorecard, but lots of missions will give you badges, like you completed the mission. So everyone on the team would get the badge, unless they obviously already had the badge, right?
Well, that's more like an achievement. Yeah, correct. Yeah, that's fine. I meant like damage number scorecard.
No, we're not fond of that because lots of players will contribute by having crowd control,
exactly,
and debuff, and healing, and they may not be doing a lot of damage. Damage is just one of the things that goes on in an MMO team arrangement like this.
Tell that to the DC Universe Online players. I mean, that is...
If you haven't figured it out, Count has a little beef.
That's probably one of the most toxic communities. That's one of the reasons I quit playing. But they have a damage scorecard at the end of every mission. And they allowed, at launch, and I think it was a big mistake, even for balancing issues. And this is my last time I'm going to mention DC Universe, I promise. Good. But what they did... was they made all the powers be able to switch to a damage roll. Even if, say, your electricity was core healer. Like, you were electric healer, but you could switch to damage. And everyone, like, would want to go damage.
Yeah, everybody's going to go
damage. And you couldn't find the support characters to even do the missions. And then might run missions with 8 damage dealers, and then here I am a healer, and I love healing, and I can't get into an instance because that's not the flavor of the month. So
that's definitely where we're headed.
Right. Yeah. Great. Okay. That's what I wanted to hear. That's what
exactly. We'll be providing a balancing that really gives you the ability to complete a mission if you did choose 8 damage dealers, but maybe it would be more interesting and potentially more fun if you had a wide selection of powers on the team. I can tell you that when I was in City of Heroes, people would occasionally say, hey, we're going to go do a quest as, you know, 8 tanks. Well, that's an announcement that you're entering the grind fest right there.
Oh, yeah. It'll take forever to kill stuff.
Nobody can hurt anything either.
Right.
Right? Or you go out and you say, well, we're going to do 8 pet masters, right? Well, now you've got 60 pets on the screen.
You've got lag issues. Yeah, exactly.
Those guys were, you know, not really tough in combat. So if the pets are alive, you're moving like a storm. But if a couple of you go down, the potential for rapid collapse was also there. That was actually interesting to do, and most players did it once over the course of 5 years, you know, but the more common was to get a mixed team where you get everybody to play to their strengths.
Right.
And part of the immersive fun of it is you learn how to play a tank really well, and then you learn how to play a ranged damage dealer really well. Then you learn how to play a healer really well. Then you learn how to play a support buff debuff, and then a crowd control, and then, you know, whatever. You learn to play the roles, and it's actually kind of fun to see the content again and realize, oh, hey, I had to keep control of that boss last time. That's not my job now. Right. Now I've got to keep the tank alive, right? It makes it like a whole new game in a way when your powers change radically.
Well, that's more of a traditional MMO. I'm sorry. I think somebody was trying to say something. I don't mean to cut you off.
No.
Maybe not.
No, I just don't think
we're good.
You said something about Pet Master. Are you going to have a summoner? Are you actually going to have a summoner power in the game?
Not at launch, but definitely down the road.
Yeah. All right.
Again, you hear me say this same kind of comment, you know, not at launch, because
that's fine.
On getting a game built and launched and have it be successful. Part of that is controlling the scope of what we're going to promise and deliver.
Yeah, all the digital projects I worked on, I often said that projects usually work fine if you manage your expectations. And that's a huge thing that I often see as a problem with like game development. You'll hear a developer throw something out there. We're going to do this. And then, okay, we couldn't get that to you. It's like, yeah, we know you tried, but you got to work the psychology of gamers, and they're not friendly. Often. Yeah. Have to be careful with what you say. You hurt their feelings badly.
Yeah. Especially nowadays.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I'm afraid I got to monologuing again, so let's jump in. Matthew, let's make a character. So, okay, you'd be able to choose primary and secondary power sets. Now, right now, we're not showing what those are yet, but we actually have built a very interesting proprietary tool that allows us to build hundreds of powers, exactly specify them. But of course, as with many things, the trick is balancing them, right?
Right.
So we actually have quite a few powers built, and we have specified our powers, but we're not showing them just yet. That's going to be probably a reveal for later in the year. Matt, let's go on to the body types. Now, I know you guys talked about this. I think we... let's build a lady, Matt. So when we go to build a character, you start out with the at start. We have over 300 morphs built into this game. So, for example, if you're looking at this character, Matt, roll us along the different base shapes for the face. For some reason, I cannot contain the correct number in my head. It's 40-something for different shapes here.
It's 49.
49, there we go.
Nice.
Actually, from this set, you could make all kinds of different ethnic characters. You can make wildly different looks. And this is the base shape. After this, we have a lot more morphs to apply. So inside the dev team, we jokingly say, you can make your girlfriend from high school. But of course, somebody else said, why do I want to make my girlfriend from high school? I want to make the lead cheerleader from high school.
Right, exactly.
So you can see you can choose any... Maybe if we go to the major morphs here, you can see we have a lot of face morphs here. You can make a character that looks like a lot of different things. Some of them are subtle and some of them are really powerful, like that skin tone. You can go all the way over to be African American. You could be a pale Irish girl. It's everything in between, right? I know Matt, who is actually a skilled artist, can show you in profile how we're changing the face there. You can make the nose very different. You can make the shape of the face. Really, you can get different shapes to the skull. As he's moving this young character around, you can see her hair move. That is because we have Apex physics built into the game for hair and for clothing, and of course for capes, because it's a hero game.
Right, right.
Yeah, that's going to be awesome for people that like me that bought. I bought XCOM 2 just for the character creation. And then I bought the DLC, just for the extra character.
Yep.
And then I made all my friends and like live streamed it and made backstories from them. That kind of stuff's really fun. So, yeah.
So, Janzer, you asked about would we have a lot of, you know, special packs, add-on packs, mod packs. Our actual starting philosophy about this is, we'd like to build a lot of stuff in for every player.
Right.
So that you didn't have to buy something extra.
Right.
We'd like to have a really amazing character creator. And we think what we've got now is actually well on the way to being that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of art that goes into this project as well. Right now we have three models, female, male, and a bigger guy. We will probably add additional models, but not until later in the year. Because what we have is a system that works right now. This tool is fully integrated. Any character you make here jumps right out into the game and can start running around. So it is it's already a very powerful character creator.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I watched the video on your YouTube channel.
Cool.
Yep.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons why people like Black Desert Online. I don't know if you're familiar with that. It's more like a World of Warcraft type, but it's more like a third person World of Warcraft type game. But they have a really good character creator with sliders and all of that. And a lot of MMOs don't have that.
Yes, Black
Desert. For the level of detail.
They do have a great character creator.
Yep.
They're notable for it.
Yep. So right there, you're kind of ahead of the game by having one that, you know, can make those little changes like that.
Correct. Also, the way we coded this, it's a platform and we can add to it. So just to put some numbers out on that, we have over 300 morphs in the game in this character creator right now, but databases are custom coded to hold more than 1,000. And we could take that number up. One of the things we're actually looking at is we'd like to add the ability for someone to sort of race through the character creator. Because we think some of our player base will literally spend a day or two or three getting exactly what they want.
Oh, yeah.
But some guys would like to just say, you know,
randomize.
You know, make me Lightning Babe and let's go. Right.
I'm gone. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
there's actually a YouTube series that's kind of hilarious where they'll go to different character creators in games. And I think it's called Monster Creator. And I think one of the bigger games news networks handles that, but where the guys, they work for them and they just make the most weird looking characters and those things blow up on YouTube. It's hilarious. So yeah, having all the different options there is just, like you said, it's important to quite a lot of people. I think now there's definitely a market that will enjoy that. And then there's the other, like I used to be, which is, I just want to pick a character, you know? So somehow I got into like, let me just fine tune every aspect of this character.
Well, if it's a genre I care about, like if I'm playing a fantasy MMO, I just want to go. I just hit randomize and go. But if it's if it's actually my superhero that I'm creating, I want to make him look like I did in the other game. I want to make him look exactly, exactly to a T, what my vision for that character is. You know, he's got to match the name, but I always made a villain, but he's got to match the theme of the name and everything. So,
let's jump over to the costume factory here
and let's show a couple of things there. So, I would just draw your attention. One of the interesting things here, of course, you've got a color wheel, right? But the RBG numbers below would allow you to exactly type in, I know for whatever reason, mystical certainty that I want my R number to be, 101 and my B number to be 136. You could exactly reproduce that.
That is lovely.
You could put it across all of your characters, right?
Cool.
Cool. Some of us would, you know, we would make characters with themes. So you might want to have five or six that were similarly colored but different archetypes, different powers, male, female, whatever. People write stories about their characters and they say, well, you know, Lightning Babe is the sister of Lightning Bro, who is also on this server, right? Whatever, we're going to enable all of that because that's part of the immersive experience in a superhero game.
Yeah, definitely. You have your team that you can pull different characters from. That's awesome. But that all are on the same team, like look-wise. Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Now, I had a question about appearance. Say, I'm sure you're going to have gear drops in the game, right?
Yes.
Like, you know, say your character looks a certain way and there's a gear drop and you equip that gear drop. Is he going to have to adapt that look of that gear drop? Or are you going to be able to have like he'll still get the stats from the gear drop, but are you going to be able to make it where he still keeps his base appearance?
Yeah, let me talk about that. Okay. In Ship of Heroes, appearance and powers are completely dissociated.
Okay.
You could have a 5 foot tall girl who's a tank. You could have a big bulky guy who's 7 feet tall and he's a healer. The costume you put on him is the costume you put on him, and you can change that costume, but it has no effect on powers whatsoever. If you get a gear drop that is, you know, something that's going to enhance your powers, you slot that in as a cybernetic enhancement or
or
whatever. It's Beautiful. In the backstory. You don't see it.
Gotcha.
Correct.
Well, that's the way it should be. I mean, you know.
Correct. That is our view. If you've made a superhero and you spent 2 days making him or her look the way you wanted it, the last thing you want to do is get the helmet of ultimate protection and have to put it on your character and say, now I can't see the hair I planned.
Exactly. Right. Okay.
Yeah, we don't like that element, so we've completely coded it out. Powers and appearance are totally separate.
Okay.
Interesting.
Nice.
Yeah, that's definitely the community would be split on that for sure, because some people would like to see the equipment that they pick up because it modifies. On the other hand, that allows other people to easily identify, oh, well, that guy's a whatever it is, and that kind of takes some of the mystique out of playing a game, you know, especially a RPG, you know, and it's an MMORPG, a role-playing game, so... If you build your character a certain way, but then it's like, oh, well, that guy's a tank. I can see because he's got the helmet of, smashing or whatever, you know. So everybody tends to look the same that way, too. Yeah.
True. Which gets annoying. Although it's relatively straightforward to simply put an identifier on everybody's character so you can see what their archetype is. Because archetypes generally have roles, but also, you know, you could tank with a non-tank character. You could make a melee powered character who's just really tough. Maybe he gives up a little damage, but he's very tough. He can go in and tank a lot of missions. He may not be able to tank the ultimate missions. You may need a real tank, but you know, a melee character is going to be tougher than, say, a healer in terms of taking damage.
Right.
But without the equipment dictating the look of what your character is, you break the issue with everyone looking the same because they're the top level tank or whatever it is, you know, because they have certain gear. So that's really nice. Yeah.
In our view, that's positive. You know, Supergirl could tank a mission. Right.
But to me, that makes more sense in a superhero MMO than it would maybe like a fantasy MMO where your character's probably going to have armor.
Correct.
And you might have different armor. You might have chainmail, and you want to look like you have chainmail on. But superheroes normally don't, they don't change their appearance. Their uniform is like specifically theirs, you know. So it's not like they're not wearing generic armor, you know. So
yeah, if you're playing the Dragon of Doom in a medieval game, it would be unusual if your character were the healer on the team. I agree.
Right.
Yeah.
So, Matt, you want to jump us over to the register line here? I think our guests have seen a lot of costume options. So I'll just say, you know, sort of wrapping this up, this is where you would finish your character. You'd choose a name, and you'd be able to type in a character description, because a lot of our player base wants to write a story about the character they built and put it in on the character and have it be viewable by other players in the game. So you could say, hey, this is
nice.
Super Lightning Babe, and you know, her powers manifested at the age of 3, and you know, Lightning Bro is her older brother, and whatever, you know, you could put that in. You could tell the story. So you don't have to play as somebody else's character. It's another element of you're actually making your own character.
What's the character tag? Is that more like a title? Because you'll see in other MMOs where characters have actually, you have an option to put a title on your character. But
in this case, we're thinking of giving characters a tagline, actually.
Oh,
and gotcha. So, for example, one of our signature heroes, Ambassador.
Oh, okay. I got you.
He's actually a tanker. His tagline is, "Who wants to negotiate now?"
Yeah, I got you. Yeah. Okay.
Because he likes to get in and brawl with enemies.
I got you. I understand.
That'll be interesting.
Yeah, because most superheroes have their little calling card, you know.
Exactly.
It's clobbering time or something like that. Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
That's pretty cool.
Character name. Yeah, I see super group affiliation. I'm assuming that's like in-game groups that you can create, or is that something like in-game?
Correct. That's essentially, we're trying to figure out a better name for that, but what would your guild be? Are you in a guild?
Right. Okay, gotcha.
Have you been invited to one? So I think in general, it would always start out as none when you launch a character into the game. Mm-hmm. And then when you're invited to a guild, if you accept, that would show up here on your ID, right?
Great. Cool.
Gotcha. Supergroup. Yeah, that's fine.
Mm-hmm. And will you be tied to one guild or group or whatever? I know some MMOs allow you to cross or be in like up to 3 or 4 or 5 or something like that, different groups.
I think what we're expecting our player base to want, although again, I'd give the caveat, you know, we kind of give the people what they want, but most characters would be in a single guild, but players could have 10 characters and be in 10 guilds.
Right. Yeah. Cool. Cool, cool, cool. Yeah,
Go
ahead.
Oh, go ahead, Janzer. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I'm not really a fan of like having to be part of like 5 different guilds just to get something done. So
correct.
I like just being part of one, because it tends to break your community when you're part of like 5 different ones, because you don't really belong to anything. So,
yes, I understand that point. So you could certainly put all your characters into one guild. I'm afraid City of Heroes actually had a limit. A single guild could only have 50 characters in it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
Not 50 players, but 50 characters.
50 characters. Yeah. Okay.
That doesn't actually work for us. So, on the other hand, I would say this too. We have a desire to create a situation with the community, with the gaming community who are playing Ship of Heroes, where pickup groups are fun to play. Okay. And so we want to build in some elements where a new player could come in. Maybe a guild would say, hey, we've got 6 guys going right now. Hey, look, there's a new guy. Let's just add him to the team and see if he's good. You know, kind of a friendly environment like that.
Right.
That's an aspirational goal, but we are interested in having that happen.
Cool.
Do you have any art done for, like, I know you guys don't have a whole lot of art done, but do you have any more, like, superhero-looking, like, outfits?
Actually, on our website, we've just started building a day or two ago an image gallery. So I think we have 50 or 60 images there, including we put up the original concept art, and then we put up the first 2 signature heroes costumes, and then we've got about a dozen shots of the city, and we've got some interesting stills taken from a couple of the videos, and then we've got
I'll
the
check it out.
50 art for All right. that we use to build our signature heroes.
I gotcha.
One of my favorite shots just went up there, and it's a shot from the character creator video at the end. You know, we make those 2 characters, we make an NPC, and then we make a hero, Sword Blossom. Mm-hmm. We put them into the level, and what we do is in the video, you can see there are 3 or so maybe other NPCs standing around, and then another signature hero, who is Ambassador, walks along behind the ladies, appears to see that they're getting a picture taken, and is kind of quietly checking them out because they're both nice looking gals.
Right.
Yes, yeah, right.
Yeah, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Nice.
That's Ambassador nice. Looking at the girls as he walks behind.
Yep, yep. Cool.
So there's a lot of interesting stuff here. You can see that the ladies have two different standing animations. You know, we have over 1,000 animations in the game already. And, you know, just sort of building a whole bunch of interesting pieces of the game. It's very exciting, very fun.
Can I ask you about travel modes? I know I'm jumping off the subject a little bit, but I was kind of curious. Like, what are some of the travel abilities that some of the characters? That's kind of a big deal. It was kind of a big deal in some of the other superhero MMO games, but I mean, you're obviously going to have flight. I'd correct. Imagine.
So we've custom coded flight. In fact, okay. Matt and I are going to be doing a video test of that this evening with a couple of our other dev team members.
Oh, nice.
We've custom-coded flight for our game because we think superheroes, flight is a thing. I mean, not every hero can fly. We're not forcing heroes to fly, but okay. Certainly you'd have flight, you'll have super speed.
Super speed,
you'll probably
okay.
have a couple of nice. Other powers.
Okay. Any hint about another movement mode? I was just kind of curious, like maybe teleportation or, that might be hard.
Teleport's an interesting power. And we're
hard to code, I imagine.
I don't know if we'll have it at launch.
Right.
But I think there are two elements that teleport. First, teleport yourself as a travel power. But I happen to think it's kind of interesting gameplay if you can actually teleport members of your team to where you are and mm-hmm. give that a relatively long range. Because that means if that you're in some terrible spot and you've got a guy who's got stealth powers and invisibility, he can perhaps move through the enemies, get to a safer spot, you know, halfway or three quarters of the way through the mission, and then one by one teleport his teammates to that spot. That can enable you to do a speed run of a mission if you want to.
I see.
So we kind of like that element too.
Yeah, I bet your lead designer guy is probably grimacing though. That would probably be hard to implement into the game.
I can't see Matt right now. He may be grimacing.
That's actually not that hard to code, believe it or not.
Oh, okay. All
it's
right.
Pretty simple. Yeah, it's just a translation, translator. So it's transform, sorry. Yeah, it's not a big deal.
What about any sort of gadget movement? I know I'm fishing for
I love gadget
some
movement.
Info.
And in particular, I'll tell you.
Like a hoverboard or something to that effect. I was just curious.
I personally love the idea of having a jetpack.
Oh, that would be awesome.
And yeah. Since it's the 25th century, I think yep. your jetpack should be big when you use it, and then it should somehow, you know, disappear into a pocket dimension and not be dragging you down
right.
while you fight the enemies. But I have always liked the jetpack idea.
Cool.
Yeah,
I
no
see
doubt.
Some of these shots have different daytimes. I play The Division quite extensively, speaking of like having multiple characters and all that. And mm-hmm. one thing that really brings a fresh aspect to replaying missions is that sometimes you go in the mission and it's nighttime and it makes the game, it makes that feel totally different. It seems weird, but it really does because the lighting's all changed. You know, it's just, it feels so much different. Is that, I guess that day night cycle is going to be part of the game as well here?
Yes, it is. So in the backstory, these levels are obviously you're inside a giant ship and they're mechanical constructs that people live in. They're born on the ship, they live there, they die there, spend their whole lives there. So they've made it look like they're on a planet, made it look like they're on Earth. And there will be day-night cycle. In fact, I think toward the end of this month, February, we're going to be showing some night scenes because we've got an idea to show a little video where you can see the starry sky at night and the clouds sort of wisping across the star-lit sky while we're doing some stuff in the video. And I think that's actually really attractive. I've seen a first cut at that. I actually think it's really cool. Obviously, you've got lighting-wise, it looks like there's a blue filter on everything like it would at night. The whole city changes character at night.
The evil's probably ramped up a little bit at night as well, I'd imagine.
That is correct.
I'm hinting.
and at some levels, it's very important. Correct.
Right.
So, if you think about the ship with 20 levels, that means we've got the ability to take, say, one whole level and say, we're going to let that be filled purely with dangerous life forms that produce good loot. Because hunting and harvesting on that level is very challenging, very difficult. You could be killed a lot of times, but the loot is extra good. And that means you've got a harvesting mode that supports the crafting in the game and supports a lot of other stuff. It's also will be a challenge level, right? So more difficult than some other levels. We think our player base wants to have variable level of challenge. And that's one of the ways we do it.
I think, too, if I'm getting the backstory correct, Casey, I don't know if it's something we wanted to get into or not, but I know that the unobtainium causes a higher instance of development of superpowers, but that it can also cause mutations, that those superpowers don't always take a useful form. And those might be some of the levels where those creatures are, those mutations are living, essentially. When you talk about higher levels, more dangerous
That's
creatures.
Correct. The backstory here is that the unobtainium is an amazing, powerful, dangerous element, which is not normally found in significant concentrations except in space environments. And so that element we've selected aboard the ship, the isotopic mix, which is particularly good for humans. So the crew, okay. The passengers, the civilians aboard the ship, they are sort of the best that they could be naturally. And a small fraction, maybe 1 in 100 to 1 in 1,000, is actually a superhero born that way. However, that particular mix doesn't necessarily mean that it's good, you know, for sharks or cats or whatever alien beast you've picked up on another planet that has snuck aboard the ship and gone native, right?
Okay.
The mutations and transformations that they would experience would not be good because it's not optimized for their species. So you've got dangerous life forms aboard the ship that have to be rubbed out
on a
regular basis.
All right.
It's just it's a fact of life.
All right.
Nice. Trying to think what other... I know I had some more questions, but let's see. Jumping ahead just a little bit, and I know you probably don't have this. Is this going to be a subscription model or?
Correct. We're looking at a subscription model here. It actually surprised us on our forums that a large portion of the player base is not eager to have a big free-to-play
right.
game. And in particular, I think they're not free to have guys that jump in, play for 2 months, and leave, right? There is a powerful community element where people get to know each other and they know that the other players are skilled and positive people to be around. That's part of the game.
Okay.
We also, along with that, we have the plan to have continuous chat moderation, right? So it's not going to be a free-for-all.
Yeah. Right? Oh, yeah. Jumping into games and buy so many things of unobtainium for this because I have a bot that farms it. Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
You're going to suppress gold farmers, something fierce.
Where they spam the chat and everything like that.
Yeah. Isn't that destructive to the immersion fun of the game?
Yeah.
Yeah, I tend to shut down all of my chats and MMOs because of that. Yeah,
correct.
Yeah.
It's kind of surprising how many MMOs let that kind of stuff go on unchecked.
Yeah,
I know. Marvel Heroes is having a problem with some of that. Which, you know, I put those on the chat ban. As soon as I see them start spamming, I put them in the chat ban. You know, but I don't know. I know there's some MMOs that ban people for that. They ban people for buying it, but like, why would you let them even offer it on your site in the first place?
Yeah.
And then you're going to ban the people that fall for it, you know, so.
Yeah.
That's kind of crazy.
Kind of changing direction here. This is one question I was trying to bring back up that I had initially. Looking at all the buildings, I know some of these buildings you can go into. What percentage of the buildings can you enter?
Right now, a couple of the buildings can be entered without having a instance transition.
Mm-hmm.
In general, most buildings will be instance transitions, at least in Apotheosis City. The reason for that is because it allows us to have control of the number of players in an instance, which allows us to have more players on the game in the server, right? So we want to be able to take a team and put them in an instance so they can do their mission and not have anyone else, you know, fooling with the mission while they're running it. So most of the buildings are sites for missions.
Gotcha. The other, I remember the other two questions. Destructibility of the environment, is that part, is that a thing? Is that going to be a thing?
It's probably not going to be a thing right now. Mm-hmm. At least in the sense of, you know, like picking up a crate and hurling it at an enemy or destroying it. We would like to do that in mission instances, but not right. in the general level.
Not in the, right.
Right. So we actually think it'd be cool to have missions where you could destroy stuff and sort of get, you know, extra XP and loot for it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm, one of your characters bigger. Might throw projectiles. You'd be able to pick up.
Oh, yeah.
I'm thinking bigger, like buildings getting, you know, not destroyed, but damaged. And because I did hear that, which kind of leads to the next part of the question, which is the crafting. I heard that. What sort of crafting are we talking about?
Well, we want to enable people to craft a number of things. First off, craft tools and other elements that will allow you to enhance your powers. And a certain number of those enhancements would go on each power. There's a limit to how many you can have total. So it's part of the strategy of the game to say, well, maybe I've decided my attack chain is going to be 6 attacks. And I've decided for whatever reason I'm really going to enhance power 1 and power 4 and leave the others only lightly enhanced. This will allow you to not only choose powers that fit your playstyle, but change the way the powers work to further enhance your playstyle. So that if you had two fire devastators who had chosen the same powers, they actually might play very differently because of the way you've enhanced it. That stuff will all be crafted. In addition, we're putting in a day job system where when you go to the game, you can choose to have a sort of a career. What would you be doing on the ship? Would you be in ship security? Would you be in engineering? Would you be in medical services? Would you be a bounty hunter? Would you be a harvester crafter for a living? You know, lots of options. And depending upon your day job, you would learn some proprietary stuff. If you went to engineering, for example, you might learn how to make weapons or make better armor or something like this. If you went to ship security, you might learn to make grenades. If you went to medical services, you might learn, you know, how to make special power-ups and healing potions, that sort of stuff. If you were a bounty hunter, you might learn how to make stealth projectors, and you'd be able to use those.
Okay, cool.
You'd also be able to make them and sell them.
Okay. All
right. Oh, like you're going to have an auction. You're going to have like an auction market.
We are going to have an auction market. I will say that, you know, lots of issues about this are balancing issues.
Yeah.
If you don't want to be a crafter trader, you don't have to. The game will be fun to play. You just go buy the stuff. Kill some extra enemies. Run an extra raid.
Right.
Go slaughter some bad guys, get the money, and you just buy it, right? I mean,
gotcha. If you don't feel like crafting, you can just, you can earn the currency, and then somebody will have it for sale in the auction house. Okay.
Correct. There are guys who craft, and there are guys who are less intrigued. We want to make a balanced game where they both find themselves happy.
What about item trading? Go ahead, Janzer. I'm sorry.
No. Go ahead. Item trading. Yeah.
Yeah, what about are characters going to be able to? You're going to be able to be able to swap any items between characters, like one guy finds something in a raid and the other guy wants it.
Sure.
Are you going to roll on for one? Are you going to roll on loot, or is it going to be everyone gets loot?
Everybody gets loot.
Okay.
The computer decides which pieces you get.
Okay.
We think that's a little bit toxic to have people arguing about loot.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, big time.
We don't like that. need versus greed. I don't like that mechanic.
I don't like it either. Yeah.
And another element is if you go and kill 5 bad guys, you don't have to kneel at their bodies and ruffle through their pockets to get your loot. Oh,
thank you.
Yes. Thank you. So, yeah, it automatically is just there. And
correct. Yeah. Pops up. Yep. You get it. I don't like that rifling their pockets. Who invented that?
I don't know. That's
more of a realistic war kind of thing where you have to go to a body to get ammunition out of it. That's grim. Yeah. However, that made it into games, I'm not sure. But
well, the same with the need and greed system. I'm sure it was a good idea maybe at first. You know, I think World of Warcraft started that. And then, you know, no, every game.
Dark Age of Camelot, I played way back in the day. Okay. That's like my first
Did it
toxic...
have the need?
Yeah, that's
Did
my
that
first...
have the need and greed? I didn't know that.
No, okay. I didn't. But that's the first instance that I had where it was player managed, meaning loot would drop. And it's like, well, I'm the tank, so that's a tank piece. I get that. But somebody else could take it. So there goes the bullshit part of it. Yeah.
I've seen leagues on DC. We had leagues break up over people rolling on other people's gear.
Hey, man.
They're like, oh, I'll just use it on some. One guy was like, I'll use it on a different character. And it's like, you know, you can't trade that to another character. Oh, I'm sorry. You know, stuff like that. Just any excuse just to roll on somebody else's loot, you know.
You know, there's a story I tell about the social element of the game, which I think illustrates kind of what we're trying to aim for. Doesn't mean we'll get it, but what we're trying to aim for. Back in the days when City of Heroes was alive, I was playing an ITF, which was a common quest that people did, the Imperius Task Force. And we're about a third of the way through it, and suddenly someone on our team said, oh, hey, guys, I'm sorry. The baby just woke up. Do you want me to quit? And the whole team said, no, don't quit. Park your character outside so you get some loot and stuff. Go take care of the baby, and when you're ready to play, you can just rejoin. We'll carry you for a while.
Mm-hmm.
That is the kind of culture we're trying to accomplish here. Not maybe always going to get it, but you know, we're doing game design to encourage cooperative attitudes.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's good.
Yeah, that's good philosophy. That's really good. Yeah. I mean, you're always going to have some problems, you know, with the with the community and everything.
You know, people come home and their boss was bad to them and they're just not in a good mood. You can't avoid that, right?
Yeah. But we've got decades of, like, player, you know, psychology in regards to MMO now. So, I mean, literally decades. So there's a lot of predictive ideas that you can build in design-wise with development. So that's like user interface, user interaction stuff. That's like what I deal with. Ship. You mentioned the ship ramming stuff. So is that going to be a special thing where players can control the ship, maybe?
Probably not, but if you envision this, raiding is a part of the game.
Mm-hmm.
And so raids could come in and you've got to repulse them. Raids could go out. So what happens if the ship is, you know, under attack by four or five other really large ships? Now, this will not be at launch, but you could see the front of that ship ramming another ship.
And that's going to be a totally driven event by the game,
and
but not
what
by
you could
players.
Do is, what we could do in that situation is we could say, you know, hey, we could announce it in advance and say there's going to be a space battle, there's going to be a raid of massive proportions, and maybe 200 or 300 or 400 players are going to go off after the ram and jump into the punctured enemy ship and try to loot.
Oh, okay. Oh, lovely. Yeah.
Nice. Okay.
Right. Awesome. So that sort of thing could go on for 12 hours or 24 hours before we back the justice away from that gaping hole and escape, right?
Right.
And the loot we get in that time frame, that could be an interesting game mechanic.
That could be like an event, like a game-wide event that you could only offer like certain times or
correct
or something like that. Yeah, it's like a special.
Maybe something like that happens twice a year. Or, you know,
oh, that would be okay.
One of our perspectives on keeping the game fresh is that since the ship goes to planets, and actually I realize we probably didn't explain this maybe as well as we should. The ship isn't just like jumping through hyperspace and then arriving at a planet 3 minutes later. It's moving faster than light between planets. So more similar to, say, Star Trek than to Star Wars, right?
Right, right.
Where they say, oh, you've got to go to, you know, Sirtis 9. We'll be there in 5 days, right? So you're moving from place to place. While you're in space, there's a set of threats that occur in space. While you're at the planet, there are adventures that happen on the planet. There are also crafting and harvesting opportunities on the planet. Then you go to the next planet. You're in space again, more dangers. You know, you're moving from place to place, so the alien enemies that are opposed to you change. The game could be constantly refreshed simply by the mechanism of moving.
That's something that I had a thought about, but I'm not sure that it's even part of the scope of the game. But since the ship is all, you know, everyone's in there, and there is a crafting aspect, and you go planet to obtain things, is it maybe a community-driven upgrade of the ship, you know, where everybody contributes to, like, okay, we need to upgrade. Did we lose somebody? What was that? Where people, as a community event, contribute to, like, upgrading, you know, engines
that
or
would
shields
be cool.
Or,
yeah.
You know. That's I'm not sure that that's part of the scope of the project or anything, but when you talked about, like, having ship combat, I was like, well, does that mean players? Somebody's going to helm that? Or does that mean, you know, somebody has to go to engine? You know, like, you have to have maybe a guild go to the engines and, you know, upkeep that well something? And I don't know. I'm Absolutely. Starting to think on a different level there, I guess.
Yeah, we actually would like to build bigger raids, bigger efforts where multiple teams had to go to certain places and defend certain aspects right. of the ship, maybe defend engineering, maybe defend the arch. Some might be on offensive duty. We also would like to have, as a regular feature of play, the ability for multiple team to form up and do raids on enemy ships, perhaps mm-hmm. by teleportation to the ship, where the window only opens for, say, 30 minutes. You've okay. got to get in there, raid, find, yeah. you know, get loot, accomplish damage. That's by cool. the way, that would be, conceivably at least, a good opportunity to arrive in a destructible environment.
Yeah, there you go.
Well, I've seen a game implement kind of something like that. Marvel Heroes actually did that about a year after launch when the Thor movie came out. They put in when Thor 2, the sequel, came out, they actually put in a event where everyone, like Janza was saying, everyone on the server had to go around and contribute materials to try to open up a rift. It was like the whole community working together, where you'd bring back the material and drop it in a certain location to open up like the Bifrost rift, and then like enemies would come out of that rift and you could get loot by killing. It was kind of like a server event.
Yeah.
You know,
wow,
something
that's
like
really
that.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
but
my
they
idea
took it
was...
they took it out of the game though.
I was thinking that you apply that to like an ongoing persistent upgrade of the ship kind of thing where
yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah. Answer. Yeah.
Where your ship, you know, the Justice gets better shielding, or if people contribute to it, you know. So that way groups can, you can even do like a leaderboard system where they, it's like, it shows what guilds or groups have contributed the most. Granted, you can get a little bit
that would
of,
be cool. That would be, yeah, that would
I think because it's a positive thing, it's not yeah. so toxic, because it's like, okay, well, this group contributed so much to shielding or to, you know, the, an upgraded RAM or upgraded engines or something.
Exactly.
I don't know. Be interesting.
So a confrontation.
We are interested in keeping it positive. Yes.
So yeah. a confrontation with another ship while you're traveling, like an NPC ship, you know, yep. Could be like you're talking about like kind of like an open world event where it would yes. like just occur on certain. Would you have like an announcement, like another ship is coming in, like or something like that,
Correct.
Like on the screen, and everyone would gather around. Everyone, it'd be kind of like a call of duty to all the heroes to get together, drop what you're doing, and everybody in the community kind of join yeah. in for 30 minutes or something. I yes. like that stuff. I like where I'm with my guild members and I'm doing missions throughout the whatever, you know, throughout the city or whatever I'm playing, and then we have to drop everything what we're doing and act as a kind of the community comes together to repel whatever threat or
right.
or beat
yes.
whatever monster,
like Dark
whatever.
Anchors in ESO.
Yeah,
Dark,
speaking to that
exactly.
specifically, yep. speaking to that specifically, we are literally thinking that there will be raids that can be set off by players where aliens come to retaliate. They beam through the defenses and they, you might say, you know, alien incursion detected on level 5. All heroes
okay,
are level 5.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting at. That would be awesome because, like Janzer said, they have a thing in Elder Scrolls called a Dark Anchor, and it just, you can hear it off in the distance, like it coming down from the sky. It's like an invasion from another yeah. dimension, and yeah. everyone runs over there as fast as you can. They have the same thing in Final Fantasy 14 online, where
yeah,
you do that
like
as well.
We like that mechanic quite a bit.
Yeah, they have an Odin fun. Event where when the sky gets where the grant every the fog starts getting thicker, and it's called an Odin event where Odin actually appears and you have to like hunt him down, and the whole server gets together I mean, you're talking like 200 people get together. And, they actually do a good job of minimizing the lag of that. But I've seen 200 and 300 people fight like one character, like one big boss battle. And then everyone goes on their separate ways after that's after that's over. So
yeah, we like that exact mechanic quite a bit.
Yeah.
That can be done with giant monsters. It can be done with alien invasions.
Yeah, I love that idea for the game. I mean, that right there is a huge selling point.
And if you think as well, it can be done differently on every world that's visited.
Right. Something could be different. It could be an alien ship. It could be a monster. It could be,
an invasion of snowmen 60 feet tall.
Exactly. Something. Yeah, exactly. So
could be a rogue AI animating the junk pile. Who knows? Yes.
Well,
no doubt.
Well, gentlemen, are we good? How'd we do
that? I mean, I could, like you said, I could go on all day. I love superhero MMOs. You know what I mean? That's kind of my thing. Like I said, I could probably try to pick your brain for another hour or so, but I don't want to, could you give me one hint of like some other powers you're going to have in the game? I know you said fire, like Devastator fire.
Absolutely.
Could you give me a teaser of like maybe another power or two,
absolutely,
like a type of power?
We certainly have powers that offensive powers that are fire, that are electric in nature, okay, that are various kinds of dark energy and dark matter that you'd find in space.
Nice.
We'll certainly have powers that are straight up, physical powers. For example, Sword Blossom is using some very powerful swords, and we will have magical powers as well.
Nice. Nice. Okay. Good enough. I like the dark energy idea.
Yes.
Yeah, no doubt. You could do a lot. You can do a lot of cool stuff with that, I imagine.
I think we can too. Yes.
Yep. Yep. Maybe like a support type role or something. Yeah, that would be awesome.
No doubt. There's a lot you can do once you move the heroes into space and let them go from place to place. There's a lot you can do.
So I before we get off here, I have one final question for you. How much do I have to contribute to the Kickstarter to get my character as an NPC in the game?
As an NPC, that is a really interesting idea to create an NPC.
Because my online persona is Count Shockula, like a villain, so.
We'll work something out with you.
The small sum of $50,000, not an issue,
I better start working some overtime. Let me tell you.
I do advise the overtime. That's a good one.
But okay. I may hit you up with that question about putting my character in as an NPC. That would be like a dream come true, no doubt. So
we'll work something out with you, Dave. Don't worry.
All righty.
Gentlemen, thank you very much today. I appreciate the conversation. This was a lot of fun.
Oh, I appreciate the time. Yeah taking the time out of your busy schedule.
Especially the devs there that are hanging out, trying to all right, can we go now? I'm a dev myself, so whenever I have a conference call, I'm
done
like,
yet?
You guys had to have me on for this? Really? I'm just kind of hanging out. Awesome. Thanks a lot for the talk.
Yeah, no keep problem. Us updated. I'm going to definitely keep tracking this game, and I'm looking forward to seeing the Kickstarter and everything, and I wish you guys best of luck.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. Appreciate your time today.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Bye-bye. We'll see you.
I'll see you. Bye-bye.